Alright, hi everybody, welcome back to our C++ programming lecture. That is actually the fifth lecture, so we made quite some progress so far. And now let's see what we are going to discuss today. Today we will have a look at operator overloading, so how to kind of associate custom meaning to existing operators. We will also talk about memory and how memory is organized in your C++ programs. And once we got the hang of how memory actually works and how it is structured, we will talk about dynamic memory allocation, why we need dynamic memory allocation, and how we can actually make use of that. And then we will this time see some real world examples. Or it will be one example, but it proves the point. So we will see one example for which you need to implement your own custom copy constructor and copy assignment operator. And also you need to implement your own custom move constructor and move assignment operator. So in this example, you won't get away with just saying, yeah, equals default. This is not going to work today. And I will show you why that is. And then eventually, once we discussed all that, I will give you some notes on dynamic memory allocation. So some things to keep in mind when using dynamic memory allocation. And I don't know, I already mentioned it last time. So last lecture was a bit tricky with all those special member functions. And this lecture will also be tricky, but be aware that after this lecture, it can only get easier, right? So it can only get easier. All right, so let's just jump right into the first topic. Operators. What are operators? So those are operators. You have the assignment operator, right? The single equals, and you have plus, minus, multiplication, division, check for equality, right? That's the equals check. The square brackets operator, smaller, greater, smaller or equals then. And those are a bunch of operators that you can use, of course. And if you wish to mention those operators in C++, you can use the keyword operator. So operator is really a keyword. And then after this keyword, you put the token, so the operator that you wish to talk about, and then you can use that in your program. And of course, this is only a small collection here. There are lots of other operators. I have it on one of the next slides, I believe. So if you wish to overload operators, you can actually overload up to, I believe it was like 38 or something. So you have a bit of freedom here. So operator overloading, what is it? What is that thing? Operators, of course, have a certain meaning, right? If you use operator plus, in this context, for instance, it has on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side, it has two integer literals. And then this operator plus, what does it do? It just implements the addition and our summation, and it just sums up those two numbers, left hand side and right hand side, so to evaluate to 9, right? And then you have this other operator here, which is the assignment operator, in fact, which takes this 9 here, which has been evaluated on the right hand side, and stores it in the variable sum. So here's this token plus, the operator plus, in this case is the mathematical plus, that sums up numbers, right? I mean, it's just a rather natural use, I would say. But operators can be overloaded, really. So an overloaded operator may has more than one meaning. So you can overload your operator to do something else, to kind of encode some custom behavior. And the meaning depends on context. What do I mean by context? The types it is applied to. So say you design your own data type, I don't know, called X, yeah, type X. And then for this type X, you can define your own operator plus that takes on the left-hand side an operator x and on the right-hand side an operator x. That takes on the left-hand side a variable of type x and on the right-hand side a variable of type x, and then it can do something with those two variables. So you can kind of add your own operator plus for your new type x. And this really is a powerful instrument. Why is that? Because it, if you do it cleverly, if you come up with a clever design, it allows you to write code and implement algorithms exactly like shown in math textbooks. So I've written a bunch of code for some computer graphics stuff once. I mean, it's a while ago, but you can really make it work out like you have some matrix multiplications or matrix times vector, vector plus vector, and all that good stuff. And it, you can really write it down in C++ as if it, I mean, as it stands in textbook, really, which is quite neat. And the question to you, have you ever used an overloaded operator? And the answer is obviously yes, because if you remember the character output stream, here we use that std cout, the character output stream, which is a global variable. And so we could use the left shift operator to just append or move some data into the character output stream to have it printed to the command line, for instance. And another place where you use overloaded operators in a rather natural sense, depends on what you mean by natural, but that would be std string, where you can just also have one string and you append some more, some other string to it using the plus equals operator, for instance. That is that can be done with operator overloading. So here's one example. So a rather natural use of plus for strings would look like follows. You have your string A and your string B, and what you can then write is A plus B. And this just concatenates those three B's here to that four A's, right? And then the string in the result contains like four A's and then three B's after it, right? So it's just string concatenation. But keep in mind that overloaded operators should be thoroughly designed. Why is that? They should behave as expected. And so what you should not implement is like two strings and then you overload your operator plus to delete the contents of A and B and fill the results with I'm a very funny guy. So that would not be a very good use of overloaded operators, right? So don't do that. Then I briefly mentioned that already. So what operators can be overloaded? If you look it up on cppreference.com, you will find an article for operator overloading. And it's a bit small, but it should say somewhere here. Yeah, any of the following 38 operators can be overloaded. And then it just lists everything. And you can make more or less good use of that. So if you design a data type, only overload operators that are really useful, that like make it easier to use that type, and also whose meaning is clear, because otherwise, I don't know, it's really hard. If you write some code and then the people, your colleagues, for instance, looking at your code, and if they can't directly understand what it means, they have to look up if there is an overload of that operator, which can be really a pain, right? That is quite painful. So please only overload operators for which the meaning is clear. And please really refrain from overloading all operators or as much as possible. So it's not particularly cool to overload an operator. I mean, sometimes it just comes in handy, and in those cases you can overload, and in other cases I would just say, yeah, leave it be. How about custom operators in C++? So for instance, could we have an operator like multiplication, or like the asterisk, which maybe could mean, for instance, like it means in Python, the power function, right? So you can have two variables like x and then this asterisk y, and that would mean, yeah, x to the power of y, at least in Python. Unfortunately, that operator does not exist in C++, so that would only be Python's power operator. Arbitrarily defined operators would be possible, but it does not exist in C++. So you cannot come up with your own tokens, your own operators in C++. And what is the reason being? I mean, those are mostly not intuitive, and then use a function rather than an overloaded operator, right? Okay, so let's have another look at the left shift operator. So there are two possibilities, for instance, for the left shift operator, which I wanted to present to you if you have not already seen those yourself. You can have the definition inside a type definition, for instance. So let's have a look. So we define a new struct type, which we call type because we don't have any imagination. And we just give it an integer and a double as data members, and one constructor that takes an integer and a double to initialize these data members here. And then we can overload the left shift operator, and the signature is as follows. You have to return a reference to a std auth stream, and there's an input parameter on the left hand side. You also get a std auth stream reference, and as a, on the right hand side you get the type. Right here we just pass in a const ref as a parameter, and then you can, yeah, usually what you do is you just shift or move the data into the output stream, and then it gets printed, kind of, or it gets appended to the output stream. Because this auth stream type does not necessarily have to be the character output stream, could also be a file output stream. We will have an example on how that works later on. So if you implemented it like that, you can create a variable of your type using its constructor here, right? And then you can just use the character output stream to print that type to the command line using your overloaded left shift operator. And now one question, you may already saw the friend keyword here. What is friend? So friend is a keyword which you can use to define certain things, can be functions, can also be, yeah, in this case, or, operators or other types even. And friend means that the thing that you are declaring as a friend, in our case, it's the overloaded left shift operator here. Now I lost my thread. So once again, friend means here in this case that the overloaded left shift operator is able or is allowed to access the type's private data members, right? Because it's a friend, it can access the private data members. In our case, we have a struct, of course, so struct by default, everything is public, so technically there would not be a need for friend here. But if type would be a class, for instance, then usually you have your data members as private. And in order for the left shift operator to be able to access those data anyway, you can declare it as a friend. That's typically how you do it. And another possibility is to define the left shift operator outside of the type definition. So you can also just have your type with the constructor still, and then you have your overloaded operator outside of the type. Because, yeah, technically it depends. So some operators are kind of part of the type and some really are not. And so you can always put them into the type definition, then you have everything at one place, but some operators you can also define like outside. And yeah, I don't know what's best. I don't know. It's just probably a matter of taste here. So that would be the outside version. And yeah, I mean, it works exactly the same. So, and it also behaves obviously exactly the same. And in our case here, we don't have it as a friend because, I mean, struct everything is public, but otherwise, if struct also had some private data that we wish to print here, we would need to declare the left shift operator as a friend within the type too. Otherwise, we wouldn't be able to access them. Okay, so operator overloading. Let's maybe do it for our VEC3 type and let's add some more advanced operators here. So from the last lecture, recall our VEC3 data type, which we implemented as a class, and we gave it three private data members like X, Y, and Z, all of type double. And then we added two constructors. We have a default constructor, which initializes all of its data members to zero. And we have another constructor which takes in three double arguments and uses those double arguments to like initialize the data member with those inputs here. What else? We gave it some useful member functions, for instance size here, which just returns three because we in this vector we store three elements. Makes sense, I guess. We also gave it the member function Euclidean length, which just computes the Euclidean length represented by that vector. And then we can, for instance, have our overloaded left shift operator here to be able to print it to the command line, for instance, or print it to a file kind of. So our stream can be the character output stream again, but also some file output stream or some yet some other output stream. And this is how you would do it. And here you really need the friend keyword because the data members that we wish to shove into the output stream, those are really private, X, Y, and Z, right? And for that reason, we have to declare it as a friend such that the left shift operator is able to access them anyways, even though they are private. Exactly, I just mentioned that. All right, yeah, exactly. And again, this would be some other use case here where we create a variable of that VEC3 type and then we can just print it to the command line by shoving it to the output stream, really. We can, of course, now also overload different operators. So we can overload operator plus and also the square brackets operator to give access to the individual data members, for instance. So let's see, what can we do? So still, that's pretty much the same, right? We still have our two constructors here. We have the member function size, which returns the size of that thing. We have still our Euclidean length function. And here we can, for instance, overload the squared brackets operator, which is often used to give access to the data. And how do we do it? How does it work out? In our case, we implement the squared brackets operator as follows. As an input argument, it receives a size, an index, right? That is the kind of data member that we wish to access, right? And we implement it like follows, like using a switch. We check what is the case, so what kind of value has this index. If it has value 0, then we return x. If it has index 1, then we return y. And if the index is 2, we return z. And it would be good practice to check if there's anything else. So if the user, for instance, specify or wishes to access the index, I don't know, 42, I mean, that wouldn't make much sense here because our vector only has three data members. And typically you would wish to handle an error here. But unfortunately, we don't know how to handle errors just yet. So we will need to wait till we get to know in the lecture later on, in another lecture later on. And please observe that we return a reference. So we don't return a copy. I mean, technically, we could also operate the squared brackets operator to really return a hard copy. But in our case, we just return a reference to the individual data members. Okay. And here, this case, it's a bit special because for the square brackets operator here in our case, we probably also wish to have a const version of the square brackets operator. And you might ask, yeah, why is that? Why do we need a const version the way we implemented it here, returning a reference to the data members? First of all, what is a const version of an operator squared brackets, or what is a const version of a member function in general? So a const function member or operator is one that does not modify the data members. Okay, so you can declare a function member or an operator as const, stating that it should not modify the data members. So, and the problem here is that this piece of code would not work the way we just implemented it here on the left-hand side. So what would work is the following. We just create a variable using the default constructor v of type vec3, and then we can use the squared brackets operator with index 1, and we can write the value 12 to whatever squared brackets operator at index 1 is. I mean, squared brackets operator at index 1 would be y, right? So this line here really would write the integer literal 12 to the member variable y. That's how we implemented it here, right? And exactly. And the next two lines, those wouldn't work here in this case, because what's going on? So what happens here is we say, yeah, I would like to have a vector variable w of type const vec3. And this vector variable is default constructed, so all data members are initialized to zero, right? Because that would be the first constructor here. And it is const. And this squared brackets operator here, if you try to call it, kind of, if you try to use it, this won't work because the squared brackets operator, as implemented here, returns a reference to a double. However, w is const, right? And if we could get a non-const reference out of a const or into a const variable, that would kind of defeat the type system, right? I mean, then we technically have a const version of the vec3 variable, but if we could nevertheless kind of get a non-const reference to it, we would still be able to modify the things, right? The variable w, or at least one of its data member here. And this is not allowed. And for that reason, we need a const version. And how can you write a const function member or const operator? You just use the keyword const after the parameter list, right? If you have a member, a function member or an operator, after the parameter list, you write the keyword const, and then this is a const version, which does not modify its data members. And in our case, this operator is overloaded to return a const reference. And this operator would be called whenever we have a const vector variable, right? So on w, if we use this squared brackets operator here, the const version would be called because w is declared as a const vec3 variable. And this const squared bracket operator also only returns a const reference, so a reference which can't be modified here. And then the type system is happy and everything works fine. Then what we can also do is we can also overload operator plus, for instance. In our case, we just have on the left-hand side by value a vec3 variable, and on the right-hand side we take const ref as input, basically. And what we implement here is we implement operator plus to do a component-wise addition. So we have here just a for loop, and in that for loop we iterate all entries of the vectors, and we just sum it up. So whatever the vectors entries of RHS are, we just sum them up with LHS's respective vector entries and return the result as an answer here, basically. And then still we have our left shift operator, and we can print it also to the command line, for instance, in a neat and convenient manner. And what this allows us to do is the following. We can now create two vector variables, v1 and v2. And we can use the square brackets operator. I don't know, change the values, the internal values. So please remember that the square brackets operator at index 1 would change or would evaluate to a reference to the data member y. So here in this line, we're actually changing y's value and set it to 50. We can now, do a component-wise vector addition and store the result in a new vector variable v3. And we can, for instance, print the results. And the output would be something like, if I am not mistaken, would be something like this here. Yeah, that seems true. So you are now able to write the following operators yourself. You could, for instance, do a component-wise subtraction and implement the operator minus. You can also You can also overload operator multiplication to take two vectors as an argument and return a double. And for instance, you could implement operator multiplication to implement the scalar product, which is the angle between two vectors, right? So like the angle, you could implement it like that. You could also have another overload kind of for the operator multiplication, which takes on the left hand side a vec3 variable and on the right hand side a double, and then you could just implement that overload here to kind of scale the vector by this double here. And you can make it twice as long. If you multiply a vector times 2, you make it twice as long. Or if you multiply by 1/2, then you would like shorten it, of course. And this is more unintuitive, so I don't know, I wouldn't use it, but I saw that in computer graphics. So the computer graphic guys typically also overload the kind of percent, or I mean, it would be the modulus operator here. And I saw that this is sometimes overloaded as a cross product of two vectors. So cross product of two vectors is like you have two vectors and then you have another vector which is orthogonal to the plane that is spanned by those other two vectors. That can also be done. I mean, you can implement it in whatever way you would like to, but again, make sure that it is somewhat intuitive at least. What you can also overload are the comparison operators. So smaller than, greater than, smaller or equal to, greater or equal to. That can also all be implemented. And then, of course, the equality operator or inequality. And here, be smart about it, because in order to overload all the equality and comparison operators, you only really need to implement the smaller than operator and the equality operator for comparisons, right? So you only need to implement those two guys here. And all the others can be then expressed using smaller and equal, right? So don't do unnecessary work. So for instance, to give you an example, you would, for instance, implement the equality operator, and then you would implement the inequality operator by just using the equality operator, and whatever comes out as a result, you would just negate and then done, right? So that is rather trivial then. And in our example, those are a bit tricky here. At least the checks for equality are a bit tricky, because in general, be aware that it is really not a smart idea to check double variables for equality, because double is kind of special in the computer, right? Two doubles can be, or one double can be greater or smaller than another double, but it is unlikely that it is equal, right? Because due to rounding errors, it doesn't make too much sense to compare two double variables for equality. So that is usually nonsense and should not be used. So double variables can only be compared for being greater than or being smaller than, but equality due to rounding errors, it just doesn't make sense typically. Okay, so how about custom operators? I already told you that custom operators are not allowed in C++. That's still true, but on the other hand, it is still possible by using some ugly hack. And we will later have a fun lecture where I show you all of those things. So I will show you a hack how you can implement your own custom operator still, even though it's technically not allowed. So let's see how that works. It will be quite a lot of fun, I guess. But of course, it's not useful to be used for real world projects. All right. So that would be it on overloading operators. I mean, should now be able to do it yourself. And now we can go to like memory and dynamic memory allocation. And before we discuss dynamic memory allocation, we need to briefly introduce the this pointer, which is a special pointer that you usually need when you kind of implement your assignment, copy assignment operator and the move assignment operator. So what is the this pointer? Let's have a look. On CPP reference, you will find that it says the keyword this is a PR value expression whose value is the address of the implicit object parameter, object of which the non-static member function is being called. It can appear in the following contexts: within the body of any non-static member function, including member initializer list, within the declaration of a non-static member function anywhere after the optional CV qualifier sequence, including dynamic exception specification, deprecated, no except specification, C++ 11, and the trailing return types in C++ 11. And third, within default member initializers in C++ 11. So this lets you access the address of the object on which a non-static member function is being called on, which is in turn the address of the receiver object. Okay, so if the first thingy here didn't make too much sense to you, so please bear with me. We will have an example on the next slide, and it's really not that difficult. So this one here is probably a better summarization, yeah, or at least a simpler one, which should be kind of sufficient here. So this lets you access the address of the object on which a non-static member function is being called on. It is basically the address of the receiver object. So you might wonder, yeah, what is a receiver object? I mean, what does it all mean? So maybe let's have an example. Let's create ourselves some nice data type X using the struct keyword, and let's now implement a non-static member function. We will talk about static member functions later on, so ignore for now. So this is a non-static member function, right? It doesn't get any parameters, and it also doesn't return anything. And we implement my address, the member function my address, to print out to the command line the address of this object is, and then we can just use this. And this will kind of give you the address of the receiver object. Now you might ask, yeah, what is a receiver object? Okay, let's see. What we can now do is the following. We can create a variable A, for instance, of type X. And I mean, we have a default constructor which will be automatically generated. Here in our case, I didn't make it explicit, but the compiler will generate a default constructor. So, and we can construct a variable A of type X. And if we now call the member function print my address, how do we do it? We use a dot, and then we call the member function print my address. And this a here, this a is called the receiver object. So a is the receiver object. And then what address will be printed here? What is in this? This is then basically the address of that A, right? So A, of course, is a variable, so it lives somewhere in memory. It is a local variable, that means it lives on the stack of the main function. And of course, it has an address, and this address will be printed to the command line when we call this function. And then we can, of course, have another variable, B, also of type X. And here, B would be the receiver object in this case. We can, of course, also call the member function print my address on the variable B or the receiver object B. And then this line would print the address of B to the command line, which is obviously different from A's address, right? So this changes and gives you the respective address of the receiver object that receives the member function call. Okay? If you don't believe me, you can just type that into your favorite editor and compile it, and you will see two different addresses printed. That is the way it works here. That is the use of this pointer. Okay, so we now handled this, which is great. And now we need to talk about memory layout in order to make sense of this so-called dynamic memory allocation about we will talk in just a few minutes. So memory layout, how does it look like? I will present to you the memory layout in Linux systems and therefore also in the C++ programs that run on those Linux systems. I don't know, something similar probably applies to Microsoft Windows or also to Mac OS or OS X. I don't even know how they call all those operating systems. So never mind, but I mean, something similar will also take place in those other operating systems. So how does it work? So for each program that you compile, for each C++ program that you compile into a binary, once you run your program, it will have such a memory layout. Each C and C++ program will have such a memory layout when being run by the operating system. So, I mean, in general, memory is just a linear, kind of a linear string, which can contain some memories. But here we have organized it into multiple different segments. So let's see what each segment does. And here we have high addresses and here we have low addresses. Not that interesting, but just as a side note. So we have that kernel memory segment. What is in the kernel memory segment? The piece of kernel memory contains the command line parameters, for instance, and also the environment variables, kind of operating system data, right? So you probably have heard of environment variables in the Linux operating system, or also Microsoft Windows has those. And also those and also the command line parameters, they live in the kernel segment here of the memory layout. Then we have the stack segment, which we up till now almost used like explicitly. I mean, we for most of the time we just use stack memory so far. And what does stack memory do? The stack memory contains function parameters and function return address or addresses. So if you have a function, like for instance main, and you have inside main, you have a local variable int I, an integer, this goes onto the stack. And then if you call another function, for instance foo, then foo also gets pushed onto the stack. And then in foo, you can have yet another integer variable j, for instance, which also lives on the stack. And at the very end, if you return from foo, all the local variables in foo get pushed off the stack again. The operating system gets rid of them. And then we return back to main and are left with and continue execution with whatever the next function or whatnot is in main, what's going on there. So The stack contains function parameters and functions return addresses and also all the local variables. All those live on the stack. And then what's new, at least it's new to us, it was always there. What's new to us is the heap. So we also have a segment in memory which is called the heap. And the heap allows for allocations of huge chunks of memory. So on the heap you can store like enormous data. This can go on the heap. And then we have a data segment which contains the initialized and uninitialized global variables. So global variables live in the data segment. And then at last we have the text segment, which is read-only, so that is also important. The text segment is read-only and it contains the program text. And this is basically the program itself, so the machine instructions that the program comprises of. That is the memory layout for each C and C++ program, right? Okay. Again, I already mentioned that it's nothing special. So memory is just a linear piece of addressable locations. And it's divided in those individual kind of sections. Okay. I can't go too much into details here because we only have a limited amount of time. I recommend to consider this website here, which contains a small article on memory layout of C programs and also C++ programs. It applies to both. And this page really explains in detail what's going on here and why we have such a memory layout. And yeah, if you have some like 5 or 10 minutes, it's really not that long article. But I really highly encourage you to read this article. That makes understanding more clear, I guess. So, and now the question, yeah, why dynamic memory allocation? Why do I need the heap? I mean, we already use the stack for local variables and we put global variables into the data section. And I mean, that seemed like worked perfectly fine, but what's the problem here? What's the matter? So consider local stack memory of fixed size. For instance, an integer array buffer with like space for 10 integers, right? If we write such a thing here within a function that is a local variable and it's just 40 bytes, right? Because on my machine, at least, an integer has 4 bytes. And if you wish to have 10 of those, then we have 40 bytes put onto the stack. But we have a problem. So what if we wish to store more than 10 elements? I mean, once we wrote it like 10 buffer, like int buffer 10, like 10 integers in that array, we can't change its size at runtime. It's like fixed. It's baked into the program, kind of. So, and what if we don't even know the number of elements up front? So then we typically have a problem because we can't even specify how large that buffer, how large that array should be. And how do we store 1 million elements? Like what if I wish to store 1 million integers? Then I would need 1 million times 4 bytes. It's 4 million bytes. And if we add some more zeros, it can't all go onto the stack because the stack size is usually limited by the operating system. You only have a limited amount of stack memory that you can use, and that's a limit put on by the operating system. And why do we need to limit stack memory? What's the problem? The problem really is we have a stack. Like local variables go on a stack. And think about how you would need to deallocate memory if you organize your memory using the stack. Let's have an example. So if we have a main function, and in the main function, we call a function foo. And in foo, I don't know, in foo we allocate like 4 million integers on the stack, and then in foo we call some other function bar, and we have some call chain which dives down deep into the program. And the problem now is, so maybe at some point I don't need my 4 million integers any longer. So I could technically, I would like to delete them. But the problem is they still are on the stack. They still reside on the stack. And now I have also this deep call chain on the stack. And I can only get rid of my 4 million integers on the stack once I returned from all those calls that I made. And I returned from foo back into main. And then I can like pop my 4 million integers off the stack and I'm able to delocate them. And this is problematic. This is problematic. If you like put huge amount of data onto the stack all the time, I mean, you can't really deallocate, or at least you have to wait until all those functions return, such that you can get rid of that stack data. So that's the problem. And also, what if data should be used in more than one scope? That's also problematic, really. And luckily, dynamically allocated memory solves all those problems here. You can simply take or allocate what you need, the amount of memory that you need. And that also means that like there are no restrictions here on how much data you are allowed to allocate. You can just allocate everything that your RAM chips provide, like your random access memory of your machine. So simply allocate what you need. But caution, I mean, you don't get it for free. So like dynamic memory allocation is good. It solves a lot of problems, but it also comes with some at least dangerous things, right? So what is the caution here? So one thing is what you need to keep in mind, you have to do the cleanup yourself. So if you dynamically allocate memory and you do some computations with that memory, and then at some point you're done, hopefully, and then you need to deallocate that memory yourself. You need to clean up the memory yourself. Otherwise, you run into problems. Because unlike Java, C++, and also C, do not have a garbage collector. So if you allocate memory on the heap, you do some computations with that memory, you produce some nice results. And if you don't need that memory any longer, you need to kind of delete it yourself. In Java, you just can write new, and then Java, the virtual machine, will automatically get rid of that memory for you, but that doesn't work in C and C++. So first point here is free the memory after usage. So once you're done with that memory, you need to free it yourself. So that also means that memory is yours until you explicitly free it. There is no out of scope. And please also do not lose the memory handle, because if you allocate memory, you get a handle from the operating system. And if you lose that memory handle, oh, good luck freeing that memory, because you now have no way to access it because you just lost the handle. So that's also not very good. And the keyword for allocation is new, and the keyword for deallocation is delete. And this is what happens if you forget a free in a loop. So if you just allocate memory in a loop and you forget to delete, then this basically describes what will happen. So you will consume ever more memory until at some point your program just crashes because it ran out of memory. That is what will happen. So, okay, now let's get more practical. How can we actually make use of dynamic memory allocation? How does it look in practice? And in order to be able to do that, we once again have to remember pointers, because now we need pointers, really, because, I mean, there's no other way how to do it. So, how did those pointer thingies work? We have an integer variable I, which we initialize to 42. That's an ordinary integer variable I. And what we can then also have is we can have a pointer to an integer iptr in which we store the address of I. Okay, that is how pointers work, right? So a pointer to an integer stores the address of an integer. And in this case, we take the address of I using the ampersand, and we store I's address in that pointer variable. And this pointer variable IPTR now points to the variable I. And pointers now will turn out to be very useful because, I mean, you can't really get away without them. So the operator new that we use in just a few seconds, the operator new will allocate the amount of memory that you need, that you asked for. The problem here is that new cannot provide a name for the allocated memory, right? I mean, at runtime, if you call new, if you call operator new, it just can't make up variable names for you. Does it make sense? It can't make up variable names for you. So as a result, it will just allocate that memory and return the address to that memory, which we can then store in a pointer variable. So operator new simply returns a pointer or an address to your memory, which you just asked operator new to allocate for you. And caution again, please do not lose size information, because if you lose size information, you risk reads out of bounds, reads and writes out of bounds. And also do not forget to delete the memory once you're done with your computations, and also do not delete twice. So new and delete come with quite some trouble here, as you already see. So you have to take care of quite a few things in order to make it all work. So do not lose size information, do not forget to delete the memory once you're done with the computation, and also do not delete twice. Exactly, otherwise you leak memory, which we just saw in the previous slide, or your program has undefined behavior and it will crash, probably. So quite a lot to take in here, but you will see how it all makes sense in a few minutes, I hope, when we now combine pointers with dynamic memory allocation with special member functions. So in a few minutes, it all makes sense. At least that's what I aim for. One more slide on undefined behavior, because we mentioned it quite a lot on the previous slide. So there's a great talk that kind of causes nightmares to me, at least, which is called Undefined Behavior is Awesome. And you can find it on YouTube. So if you have, I don't know, if you are bored and have a few minutes, I believe it was half an hour talk or something like that. If you are bored, you can just watch it. It's quite funny. So allocate and delete memory. How does it work? The keyword for allocation is new. In fact, new is also an operator that can be overloaded. So you can actually implement your own versions of new, but at your level of programming experience, I would say leave it be at this point. The standard signatures are operator new, and you give it a size. You also have square brackets operator new, which is also called the array new, which you can use to dynamically allocate arrays. We will have examples for all those things in just a few seconds. And you still just give it a number of bytes it should allocate, basically. New is returning a void pointer. That is something that you can and should notice. If memory cannot be allocated, new can also throw an exception, which is almost never checked, even not in real programs. But technically, if operator new can't allocate memory for you, then it throws a bad alloc exception. We will learn what exceptions are in one of the next lectures. How come operator new cannot allocate memory? How can that be? That can be, for instance, I don't know, if you have 8 gigabytes of main memory in your computer and you ask operator new to allocate like 10 gigabytes, then it can't allocate that much, that amount of memory, because it only has 8 gigabytes. And it can also be that, again, let's assume your system has 8 gigabytes of main memory, then it can also be that it can't allocate like even 4 gigabytes, because maybe, I mean, on your operating system, on your machine, it's not only your program that runs, but it's also the operating system itself that runs on your machine, and probably also various other programs that run on your machine. And also all those other programs need main memory in order to function correctly and do all their computations. And it can now also be that if you ask to allocate memory, that there is not enough memory that is currently available that can be given to you. And in those cases, a bad alloc exception will be thrown, and then you have to deal with that situation. That's usually rather bad, and there's not much that you can do, but at least you will be notified by an exception. The keyword for deallocation is delete, and also delete is an operator that can even be overloaded. And the standard signatures are delete for ordinary objects, and then you also have that array delete that you can use to delete arrays. So, and the number one golden rule here is that every new needs a delete, otherwise your program has a leak. And now I say that, and you may think, okay, I mean, that can't be that hard, right? Because, I mean, if I write new in my program, I also just write a delete after I'm done with my computations. What's the problem? And the problem is if programs get more and more complicated. I mean, typically, you don't just use new in one line, but typically, you use operator new in a loop. And then you have to take care that for all those new allocations took place in that for loop, for instance, you correctly delete once you're done with that memory. So it gets more complicated. It's not just, I simply have one delete for each new. I mean, with loops and all that stuff, it is a bit more complicated. So we have new for objects, we have new for arrays, we have delete for objects, and we have delete for arrays. And as an educated listener or viewer of this lecture, you might ask yourself, yeah, why do I need a new and an array new? What's the difference? And also I have a delete and an array delete. Why do I need like two? Can't we get away with one? So what is the distinction between objects and arrays, or why is there a distinction between objects and arrays? And the problem is it's really just a syntactic oddity, so it has no use at all. And even worse, please don't confuse between them. So if you allocate an object using operator new, you better also deallocate with operator delete. So what it is not allowed to allocate with new and then delete with array new. If you do that, undefined behavior right away, good luck. So please don't confuse. Exactly. Yeah, and then we also have some more fun, because there is also the risk of double free, which is also pretty bad. And this would be an example. So let's have an example of double free. So what we can now do is, using dynamic memory allocation, we can now ask the operating system under the hood. I mean, this operator new call goes eventually into the operating system at some point. And you basically ask the operating system using this syntax here, hey, operating system, please allocate on the heap an integer, which is 4 bytes here, for instance, on my machine. And then the operating system will allocate on the heap 4 bytes for you, and it will initialize the 4 bytes, which it should interpret as an integer, with the integer literal 13. So like after this right-hand side kind of has been executed, you now have 4 bytes, an integer of size 4 bytes on the heap, which is initialized with the value 13, which is yours. And as a result, the operator new will give you an address, which you store in a pointer to an int variable I. And you can, for instance, then change its value. You can say, yeah, dereference that integer here, that I, and in order to obtain its value, and then here you can, for instance, store the value 42 in that piece of heap memory. And you can then also print it to the command line, for instance, using that stdcout and left shift operator here. And you can kind of follow that pointer, dereference it to get its contents, and then it will print 42, which is in that heap, piece of heap memory, and then it will print 42 to the command line. And now we are kind of done with our simple computations here in that case, and we can delete. So we don't need that piece of heap memory anymore, and therefore we use delete, and we give delete the address of that piece of heap memory, and then delete will just get rid of it. And then that's perfectly fine. However, if you are not careful, it can happen that you end up deleting twice or trying to delete twice. I mean, this is a rather naive, a rather stupid example. I mean, you would immediately see that you, oh, I have a double delete, which is not very good. But again, if your program becomes larger and larger, it's not like you just allocate at one place and delete at that place. Typically, it's you allocate at one place and you pass a pointer around into some other functions, into some different computations. And then it's kind of hard to spot those double deletes. And if you would have a second delete on something which you already deleted, you will get the following. If you run your program, it will just execute and immediately exit with an error stating like that you have a double free or some other memory corruption, and it will kill your program, which is usually not what you want, I guess. So what is one strategy to mitigate it? I mean, the best strategy to mitigate that would of course be not to have double delete, right? Only delete once. That's how you would write. But let's say, I mean, accidents happen, so how could you try to mitigate that problem and make it less worse? So one strategy that people usually use is they delete the thingy that they wish to delete, the piece of heap memory here, for instance, and then set the pointer variable to the null pointer. Just let this pointer I point to null after you delete it. And this has the advantage that if you call delete on a null pointer, nothing happens. Deleting a null pointer is safe. So if the pointer you wish to delete contains null, nothing happens. So that is perfectly fine. And then you wouldn't get this double free error or corruption here. In general, it is unfortunately also pretty hard to detect those memory issues. So if you do some dynamic memory allocation stuff and if you do it incorrectly, it's hard to tell if your program is even correct. That's a problem, of course. But we have some tools nowadays. For instance, we have this Valgrind tool, which is a tool that allows you to detect memory issues. And it was developed by a British compiler construction specialist. And Valgrind is in fact a tool suite that allows you to detect memory errors. And how does it work? It runs your program multiple times and it stops the program many times during its execution. And whenever it stops your program during its execution, it then analyzes in those breaks the registers, the stack, and collects all kinds of useful information. And with all the useful information that are collected in between the breaks, with help of those information, it can then determine whether a program has some memory issues. And that is pretty awesome, in fact. One problem here, however, the problem under analysis is because it has to be run multiple times and it has to be halted in between to inspect like the state of the program, the memory, it is executed usually like 100 times slower than usually, which can be a bit problematic if you have a program which runs pretty long and then it gets times 100. It's hard to analyze big projects here that just needs time. But yeah, I mean, it's still worthwhile if you wish to figure out if your program has some memory issues, right? And there are also not many ways to detect memory issues. If you have a double delete in your program will just crash. If you have a missing delete, your program will leak memory and it consumes just ever more and more memory until at some point the operating system runs out of memory and then it just crashes your program, right? The operating system will just kill your program at that point. So that's also not too good. So you can use Valgrind, and you can also nowadays use Clang's address sanitizer, which I also highly recommend making use of if you have to work with dynamic memory allocation, or actually also in general, you should use it if you develop your program. And the address sanitizer is a fast memory error detector. So it can, first of all, how does it work? It uses compiler instrumentation and it will instrument your program. It will insert like special instructions that make sure everything works fine. And it then also uses a runtime library and it causes like a slowdown of like 2x, which is much better than Valgrind with 100x slowdown. So 2x, that's okay, probably. And with help of the address sanitizer, you can detect out-of-bounds accesses to heap, stack, or global variables, use after free, use after return, use after scope, double free, invalid free, memory leaks. This is experimental still, but you can kind of detect all sorts of memory issues, which is really, really great. And in order to use Clang's address sanitizer, you need to compile and link your program with some special flags. So the flags you definitely need are this dash lowercase g. For this means basically that the compiler should introduce debugging information in your program. So if it compiles a program to a binary, it should also include debugging information. Then you say that you wish to use the address sanitizer, which you do by using dash f sanitize, and then you give the sanitizer of your desire, which is address. And in addition, you use this f no omit frame pointer flag, which is needed to get useful information from the address sanitizer. So the compiler should not get rid of the frame pointer in order to give useful error messages. So detecting leaks, how could you do it? So this would be a program which is perfectly valid. Here you, again, you allocate an integer as we did before, and you only have one delete at the very end once you're done with your dynamically allocated memory, and then this is perfectly fine, no leak. If you run that program using Valgrind, by using Valgrind dash dash leak check equals full, track origins yes, and then you have your program's name, and then it will say, okay, that looks pretty good. So definitely lost 0 bytes, indirectly lost 0 bytes, possibly lost 0 bytes. So those should all be zero, meaning yeah, then we did not lose any memory, so our program does not contain any leaks. This program does contain a leak because we allocate memory using new, but we don't have a delete for that new, and therefore we lose memory. So we would compile that program using the dash g option to include debugging information. And then again, we can run that program using Valgrind, and it will tell us the summary here, the heap summary. And it will say, oh, we definitely lost like 4 bytes in one block. And this is exactly, this is precisely here from this allocation, right? And the cool thing is that Valgrind also tells us where that allocation took place. Oh, sorry. So here it will tell us that it was in main and it was in that file and that line, so you can see where you allocated that memory that you forgot to free, which is quite nice. If you wish to use Clang's address sanitizer instead, you can also do that, of course. I already showed you the command, so you would also compile with dash lowercase g, enable the address sanitizer, tell the compiler to not omit the frame pointer, and then you compile your executable file and you run it, and then this will be printed to the command line. So the address sanitizer by Clang will print a message to you whenever it detects an error, and here it will say, yeah, I detect a memory leak, and at operator or in operator new in double free.cpp for like column 12, it will in function main, so it will tell you where the memory was allocated for which no delete exists, and then it will also tell you in a summary that you leak 4 bytes in one allocation. So those tools can be used. And now you have all the tools that you need in order to debug memory issues, at least for this course. There are, of course, also more advanced techniques, but that should be more than enough for this course. Now you have all the tools to debug your programs. Now we can see how we can actually use heap memory and what does it mean in terms of like the real memory state. So let's this time dynamically allocate arrays. We can also do that, of course. And for that we use array new with those square brackets here. And how do we do it? We use new, and we give the type that we wish to allocate, and then in square brackets we give the number of integers that we wish to allocate. And here in this case, this basically means that we wish to allocate an integer array of 10 integers, and the result, which is the address of the first element that we wish to store in that int star, in that pointer to an integer variable array. And in memory, it would look like this. We would have the array variable pointer to an integer, array variable. We would have on the stack in main, it's a local variable, right? And that thing here on the right-hand side, that new expression, that allocates memory on the heap. And so we would have 10 integers on the heap. And the address of the first thing, the address of the first integer, that we store in our stack variable array. So like this line here corresponds to this picture of memory. And what we can then do is we can use a for loop to work with that memory. We can index from 0 to 9. We start indexing arrays at 0, and we can go all the way up to 9. And here, for instance, we can write some data into it. So in this case, we just initialize all integers in that heap allocated array to 13. And we can use the square brackets operator for that. We could, however, also use pointer arithmetic, which has the same meaning as the square brackets thingy here. We could also use array plus I, and bear with me, array points to the first element. And if we add something to that first address, we will get to the second integer or the third integer or the fifth integer and all that good stuff. So here this is called pointer arithmetic, so we compute with the address. And then we are at some other address, so like for instance if we have array plus 1, we would be at this address here, and then we dereference what is at that address, which gives us the integer value, and here we add up 2 to it and just make it 15. So this is just another spelling, this is just another syntax for that that line here, but it looks kind of messy and more complicated, so I would just use the square brackets version, which is semantically the same. And at some point, say we do some crazy and useful things with that dynamically allocated array, and then at the very end we don't need it anymore, and then we have to use array delete to delete the array, and this gets rid of the allocated heap memory, and then we are left with that array variable on the stack. And that array variable on the stack will get written off for us by, I mean, the nature of the stack. So once main terminates, everything that lives as a local variable in main will automatically be cleaned up because, I mean, it's a stack, right? So there's one problem which you may have already observed here using dynamic arrays. Programmers have to store the size information themselves, right? We allocate an integer array of size 10, and if we then wish to iterate that those integers in the array in a for loop, for instance, we have to take care that the loop boundaries exactly match the array size. Otherwise, we have a high risk of index out of bounds, which again leads to undefined behavior, which is not very good. And you can play that game even further. You can now also dynamically allocate 2D arrays. How do we do that? Let's say we wish to allocate a matrix of 3 rows and 4 columns. How would we do that? We would now we would now create an array of pointers to integers and 3 of that kind. And the return value would be a, or the return type would be a pointer to pointers of integers. And the picture that you can really write down is something like this. So we have on the stack, we have the matrix variable of type integer pointer to integers. And then on the heap, we just allocated an array of pointers to integers. And then we have the address of that thing, of that first element, stored in our matrix variable on the stack, and that thingy here lives on the heap. And now for each row, so for each pointer to an integer here, we allocate an array of column integers, so of 4 integers, on the heap in a loop. So, and the result, the address that we get back from the operator new here, we store in matrix at the position row, which basically gives us the following. So we now also have like 4 integers on the heap for the first loop iteration, and we store the address in that first pointer to an integer. And we have then in the second loop iteration, we allocate yet 4 more integers. And in the third allocation, in the third iteration, we allocate yet an integer array of 4 integers. And then again, the addresses are then stored in the array of pointers to integers. And then we can, for instance, initialize all those integers here that we wish to work with to 42. We can initialize them to 42. By using a double for loop, for instance, and just accessing the integer data using the matrix variable on the stack. And we then just follow pointers. We dereference once, and we are here. And then we dereference a second time with the respective column to get the respective column here. So one of those integers. And then we initialize all of them to 42. So we can then do some useful computations. And at the very end, we have to delete everything. And we have to do it in 2 steps because we also allocated in 2 steps. So first of all, for each of those pointers, to an integer, we have to array delete the array that is behind those pointers, right? Which we do with those with this very loop here. So we would get in the first iteration get rid of that array. In the second iteration, we would get rid of that array, and in the final iteration, we would get rid of the final array. And then we are left with this situation. And at the very end, we just call array delete on that matrix variable to get rid of the array of integer pointers, and then we would clean that up. And because we are better safe than sorry, we also set the matrix pointer to the null pointer here. Such that if at some point some other guy tries to delete that matrix variable again by accident, nothing bad would happen. Okay, so that is how you would allocate arrays dynamically, one or two dimensional, and you can also play that game with arbitrary dimensions, but usually you don't have to go beyond two dimensions typically. So let's see how that dynamic memory allocation behaves for a user-defined type. So not for arrays, but just for ordinary objects, one of a thing. For that reason, or for that purpose, just have a struct vertex. Let's have a vertex type, which contains three data members, x, y, and z, all of type double. And then let's have two constructors, one default constructor, which initializes all of those variables with zero. And then one other constructor, which takes in three double arguments and uses those three double input arguments to initialize its data members x, y, and z. And then, for instance, we can also overload the left shift operator for the output stream, such that we can use cout and print variables of that type in a nice manner to the command line. So what we could now do is the following. We could now do this thing here. We can allocate a new vertex. Just give me a second. So we can allocate a vertex on the heap, and the address of that heap memory that we allocated for that vertex, we store in that stack variable of type pointer to a vertex v1. And this would be the situation in memory. So we would have the v1 variable of pointer type on the stack, and we would have the vertex on the heap. And since vertex only comprises three double variables as data members, we only have really three double variables on the heap. So the size of a variable of a type is the sum of the data members. So Since vertex only has three double variables as data members and nothing else, I mean, those are only functions really, the other things here. That means if we store a variable of type vertex, we only need three doubles to represent x, y, and z. So this would be the situation here. And we can also use the second constructor to initialize the data members to 1, 2, and 3. And we also allocate this vertex on the heap. So meaning in the situation in memory, we would have the v2 variable pointer to a vertex on the stack again. And then we would have it point to the three double variables that we just allocated on the heap. And we could also use that third thing, which is what we did previously. So previously, we only allocated on the stack. So if you write it like that, if you have a vector variable v3 of type vertex, which we initialize with the second constructor, that vertex here is allocated on the heap. And then we just have three double variables on the heap for x, y, and z. This is how it would be in memory if you draw it, kind of. And then we can also access the individual data members, x, y, and z, also for the pointer, for the dynamically allocated vertices. We can, for instance, use the kind of pointer access operand. We can say v2x, which, kind of refers to that x here, and we can set it to 42. And this error here, this kind of pointer access, is really just shorthand for take the address v2 and dereference it, and then take the variable x of that. So let's let's replay that in our memory picture here. So we go to v2, we dereference it to get the actual value of that vertex, and then we access x, which would be the first double, and then we set it to 42. And because you have to write that so frequently here, there is this shorthand here, which is the error operator, which just does both in one step. So dereference and access data. And then we can also print to the command line the contents of v2. v2 is a pointer, obviously, then therefore we have to dereference it to print it to the command line. And eventually we need to delete v1 to get rid of that heap memory, and we need to get rid of v2 to get rid of that heap memory as well. And the stack data, the stack memory is automatically cleaned up for us once main returns. All right. All right, so we now learned about dynamically allocated memory, about heap memory. And now we can apply what we already know and combine it a bit with the concept of copy constructors and move constructors and their assignment version. So let's use copy and move using the dynamic memory. First of all, I mean, let's go just naive and let's see what goes wrong if we just set the copy constructor and copy assignment operator to default. Let's see what happens. So the situation here is as follows. Let's create a struct that should act as a wrapper type and should manage a dynamically allocated integer. So we create a type, dynamic int, which manages an integer that we allocate on the heap. So in order to make that happen, we of course need a pointer to an integer. And the integer should then point to the heap integer, to the heap memory for that integer that we wish to manage with that wrapper type here. And let's create one constructor, which takes an integer as an argument. And the constructor now constructs or initializes this integer pointer here by doing the following. So first of all, we allocate using that new expression, we allocate an integer on the heap. And we initialize that integer that we allocate on the heap with the value provided as an argument. And the new expression here returns an address, which we store in that IPTR variable. So whenever we use that constructor, an integer on the heap will be allocated. It will be initialized with the value provided as the constructor argument. And the address of that thing will be stored in the pointer to an integer variable IPTR. That's how it works. And in order to make sure that we can't forget to delete the memory, we just implement the destructor here to call delete on whatever this IPTR points to. That means that whenever the destructor for that type is called, the piece of heap memory is automatically cleaned up for us. Okay. Then let's also overload the left shift operator here such that we can print that thingy to the command line. And what do we do? We do the following. For the thing that we wish to print, we take the IPTR variable and dereference it to get the value that is behind that pointer. And that value we just put append to the output stream. And again, then let's now just be naive and let's just default the copy constructor and let's just default the copy assignment operator. So in main, we can now write such code as follows. We can create a variable di1 of type dynamic integer and give it a 42, which will lead to the following thing. On the heap, there will be allocated one integer, so a piece of memory which is able to store one integer, and this will be initialized with 42, and the address of that thing will be stored in IPTR. And all that, what I just described, will be handled in the type definition here. And here, let's call the copy constructor. Let's now create a new variable di2 with di1. So here in this place, since di2 is not yet constructed, the copy constructor will be called at this point. And a copy of di1 will be performed in order to kind of obtain di2. And if we have a default copy constructor, what the default copy constructor does, if you default it, it just performs a member-wise copy. So just all the data members are copied. And then we can, in this case here, modify the heap memory and store the value 100 in that very integer on that lives on the heap. And then we can print both values. And now something interesting will happen, because 100 will be printed both times, two times. And you will think, why is that? I mean, we initialized that di1 variable with 42. Why all of a sudden, why do both of these print statements here print 100? And the thing is of the this thing, or this is caused because of the default copy constructor, which performs a member-wise copy, which in our case is not what we want. Because what happens here, if the copy constructor is called, please imagine that in that di1 variable, this IPTR points to some heap memory. And if we just by doing a member-wise copy the address that is behind, that is stored here in that variable, if we just copy that in order to create a variable of type dynamic integer, which we call di2, then the address is the same, right? So that now also means, like, both IPTR variables of di1 and di2 both point to the same heap memory. Two pointers containing the same address pointing now both to the same piece of heap memory. And therefore, if we store 100 using one pointer and we read from that other pointer, I mean, the change is visible to both pointers, because essentially they refer to the same piece of heap memory. And it gets even worse, because at the very end of main, the destructors for di1 and di2 will be called, right? And in the destructors, we delete IPTR. And the problem is now, since both addresses point to the same heap memory, the same piece of heap memory, we have a double free, because we delete once using that pointer, and then this is already gone, and this other pointer still refers to that address. I mean, we already cleaned up, but I mean, the program doesn't know and doesn't care. So we delete a second time with that other address, and I mean, the memory has already been cleaned up, so that is problematic, and that leads to a program crash. That is a double free corruption, in fact. And this is what we obtain when we run that program. So really, 2 times 100 is printed, and then we see, I mean, it can still print that 100 two times, and then when the destructor should be called, then it goes all haywire, since we then try to delete twice the same piece of heap memory. Okay, so how do we fix the situation? How do we fix? On the last slide, we just discussed that the default behavior of the copy constructor is to perform a member-wise copy. So for this copy here, this data member, this integer pointer, would be just copied. And this is, in fact, not what we actually want, because then we end up having two addresses pointing to the same heap memory. What we wish to do instead really is to create what is called also sometimes as a deep copy. So not only do we wish to copy the address, but rather we also wish to copy the thing on the heap. And when we should create a copy of that parameter, of that thing that is put in here, what we actually need to do is we need to allocate a second piece of heap memory, which is separate from that other thing that already exists. So here we allocate a second piece of heap memory, which is also able to store an integer, and we initialize that integer with whatever value is in that other piece of memory that was previously allocated for that variable that we get as an input, that of which we should make a copy. And this is then called a deep copy. Okay, so we also allocate a new piece of memory on the heap, and whatever is the value in that other piece of heap memory, we initialize that new heap piece of heap memory. And then we really have a deep copy. So we not only copy the pointer, but instead we conduct a copy of that thing that lives on the heap that this pointer refers to. Whew, yeah, that was kind of complicated, and that would already fix our problem. Because now both variables di1 and di2, both of these variables now manage their own piece of heap memory, which is completely independent. And so we can write 100 in the di2 heap memory cell, kind of. And then that di1 would still give 42, because that is unmodified, because now each pointer, the pointer iptr of that di1 variable and that pointer diptr of that di2 variable, those would now both point to individual pieces of heap memory. And if what I said is really just confusing to you, so you can also really, as I had on the previous slides, at least on one or two of those previous slides, you can really just take a piece of paper and a pen and write down what that all means. So what piece of memory lives where, what is on the stack and what is on the heap, you can really write it down to get a better idea, if that helps. So that was the copy constructor, but now we also have the copy assignment operator. So how does this work? Okay, so copy assignment operator. Just give me a second. Yeah, okay. So the first thing that we do here is we check a self assignment. So this is basically if the address of that thing I wish to assign to is not the same address of that thing I assign from. So this is basically the left-hand side of the assignment operator, and this diref is the thing on the right-hand side. And here we are comparing addresses. And if those addresses are not equal, then we don't have a self-assignment where x and x are where the same variable is on both sides of the equal sign. And if it is not a self-assignment, we wish to read out the value that is in that piece of heap memory from the right hand side of the assignment sign or operator, and we wish to store that in our own heap memory. And otherwise, we return this. We return a reference to ourselves, basically. And so in case of a self-assignment, we just don't do anything. We just return kind of ourselves. And in case it is not a self-assignment, we kind of copy the value that is behind that thing that we wish to kind of copy from or assign from, and we make it and store it in our own heap memory. Yeah, I mean, yeah, you will probably notice it's really quite difficult to even explain that. A good thing to do probably is to type that code into your own editor and see what's going on and how it feels and what is going on. And then you can also use some cout statements to exactly print what addresses go where, and also use a piece of paper and a pen to depict the situation really. But that is what's going on. And this would be a correct, a valid implementation for copy assignment and copy construction. So now we fixed copy. So let's now have a look at move. So let's also be, first of all, let's be naive about move constructor and about the move assignment operator. And let's just default them. So that was the correct implementation that we had so far for copy. And please observe that we here now wish to move. We now wish to move from DI1 and move construct that DI2 variable. And initially, we also just default move constructor and move assignment operator. And if we compile and execute that piece of program, we still get a double free corruption, a memory corruption that is not quite correct. Because what is going on? It's kind of the same problem that we had with the default copy constructor and the default copy assignment operator. So if you default the move constructor, a defaulted move constructor will also just perform a member-wise copy. And it will just copy this IPTR pointer from DI1 to DI2 under the hood. And we now end up in the same situation where we had two different pointers pointing to the same piece of heap memory. And we already learned that this is not really a good thing. Because, first of all, if we modify like the thing that is behind one pointer, we also modify what is behind that other pointer because both pointers point to the same piece of heap memory. And then, even worse, if the destructors are called at the very end of main, they both delete the same thing, causing a double deletion. And yeah, I mean, this is also what we get here, which is not very good. So how do we fix that? I already mentioned that in, I believe, the last lecture. The clue about move is move behaves different from copy, obviously. Copy really performs a copy, typically also a deep copy. That is, we also make a copy of what is on the heap, which I just showed you. And the thing about move is move steals the data from an existing thing. So if we have an existing variable of a certain type, we can just like steal its data to construct a new variable of the same type. And then, because we stole from the other variable, this other variable where we moved from which we stole the data, this can no longer be used. Okay? And because we steal the data, in some situations, you can do that because you don't need that other variable anyway. So you can just steal the data. And this is oftentimes much, much faster than a copy would be. So let's see how a fix would look like. So that is the same situation here. We have our cool copy constructor and copy assignment operator. And I mean, usage is also same, just copy and paste it here. And now the question is, how do we steal the data? How do we implement that? And here's how we do it. The input of such a move constructor, that is the variable from which we should steal the data. So once again, maybe If we now wish to move construct, which is this line here, in this line we wish to move construct the di2 variable with help of the di1 variable. So di1 would be the input to that move constructor, which we should or can use to construct this di2 variable. And what we now do is the following. We steal the data. How do we do it? We initialize our IPTR pointer, our data member IPTR pointer, with the address of the thing from which we should move. And this gives us the situation that we previously didn't want to have, but now we explicitly desire to have that situation, because by initializing the data member IPTR with the IPTR pointer of that thing we wish to move from, we now have the situation that both IPTR pointers point to the same heap memory. And this is bad, we learned on the previous slide. But now comes the clue. We now set the IPTR pointer from the variable from which we steal to the null pointer. Meaning we now have two, so we just created two pointers pointing to the same heap memory. And by setting the one pointer to the null pointer, we only have one valid pointer to that heap memory. And the other pointer is invalid because it now contains null. It's a null pointer. So, and the cool thing now is that we kind of just reused the heap memory. I mean, we never touched that heap memory really. It lives still in the same place. We now just have another pointer pointing to it, and the other pointer we just kind of set to null and kind of removed. And the good thing is, when the destructors are called for D1 and D2, one pointer will point to that heap memory and will destruct it, and then it's cleaned up. And the other pointer we set to null, and null can be safely deleted. So we don't have that double deletion issue anymore, because that other pointer now contains null. We stole from it and we just set it to null, and then it can be safely deleted without causing any trouble whatsoever. That is how you steal memory. That is what I mentioned with stealing data, because the data on the heap stays where it is. You don't have to perform an expensive copy on that piece of heap memory. And now let's discuss the move assignment operator, where the following happens. I know it's kind of complicated. I'll try my best, believe me. So, assignment operator, how do you have to read that? So that thingy on the left-hand side basically is would be this one here, and the thing, the input parameter would be the thing on the right-hand side. And the assignment operator would be called whenever the thing on the left-hand side has already been constructed. So maybe that's also one good point I should make clear here. In this case, the move constructor would be called, because di2 is not yet constructed, and we call move constructed with di1. However, if we would have constructed di2 already in another line, then here the move assignment operator would be called. And if we would use copy, then the copy assignment operator would be called. So the copy and move assignment operators are called when both variables, the one on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side, have already been constructed. That is very important. So if the variable, once again, if the variable on the left-hand side has not already been constructed, then the move constructor or copy constructor is used. And if it has already been constructed previously, then the assignment operator or the assignment version is being called. Okay, so let's see what's going on here. Once again, we check for a self-assignment. So if the address of this, the thing we just handle, and the thing that is on the right-hand side of the assignment operator, if those would be the same addresses, it's the same object, that would be a self-assignment. And then we don't do anything and we would just return ourselves, basically. We would just return this. In any other case, when the thing on the right-hand side is a different thing than what is on the left-hand side, we would do the following. Since we should steal the data, but we already constructed ourselves, again, please keep in mind then that the move and copy assignment operators are only called when both variables have been constructed previously. So if we should steal data from a different thing, from a different variable, but we already constructed ourselves, we first of all have to delete our own stuff, right? Which is exactly what we do here. So we delete what is behind our own IPTR pointer. We delete that using delete. And then we steal the data, similar to what happens here in the move constructor. So that is, we delete what is behind our pointer to get rid of our own heap memory. And then we let our pointer point to the heap memory that is behind that IPTR of the other variable. So we have this situation again where we have two pointers pointing to the same heap memory. And then we set the pointer to the heap memory of that thing that we wish to steal from. We set that to the null pointer, such that we only end up with having one pointer to that very heap memory. And since the other thing is null, if the destructors are called, everything works fine. We can safely delete that heap memory, and we can also safely delete that other pointer behind which is null, and null can safely be deleted. Okay. Yeah, and then this situation also works perfectly fine, and this is exactly what we want it to. So, okay. So we are almost done. That was more or less the hardest part, and you can also try it out yourself. You can copy and paste that code into your own editor and play around with that. But also on the next exercise sheet, which is corresponding here to this lecture, I ask you to implement your own vector type that uses dynamically allocated heap memory, which is basically you have to do it yourself, which is great for practicing it, for understanding how it works. And so you have to do it yourself in the homework for an array rather than a single integer. So no problem, you will get a feeling for that and how it all works out. I told you, learning a new programming language takes time. So, but now you can relax a bit because you know how to handle the special member functions in the context of dynamic memory allocation, and it will really not get any more complicated than that. So that is you now, once you understood what I just told you here, hopefully after the next exercise sheet. Then that's basically you who can now stop bullets, and it won't get any more complicated than that. And if you once got the idea here, the rest will be very easy again. Okay. One more note on special member functions using built-in and STL types. So STL types provide many useful constructors. You already used some yourself by creating some std vector variables, or also you use std string and std map and those STL types, and those provide many useful constructors. And the STL types also know how they have to be destructed, copied and copy assigned and move assigned, which means if you are dealing with types containing only primitive, that is built-in data types such as int, double float, character, all that good stuff, or STL data members, equals default is fine. So in case, again, I mentioned that last time already, so if your data type only uses built-in and STL data members, that is perfectly fine. You can just set the special member functions to default. However, if you are dealing with dynamic memory allocation yourself, you now know how to deal with these special memory functions and how you need to implement them such that they do their job correctly. Okay, note on dynamic memory allocation. So typically in modern application programming, you rarely need new and delete in your programs. Kind of too error prone, but most of the time really it's too low level. If you only do some application programming, you get away with not using new and delete at all, typically. So what I just said, usually no need for raw new and delete. There are of course some exceptions, and in those cases where you actually need to use them, you now know how to use them. If you need to allocate an object, just do so using stack memory. Yeah, I mean, if you need to allocate an object, just put it on the stack as we did already so far. And return by value, because the return value optimization and std move will take care of performance, so you don't need to worry about that. You can also move a variable between scopes if you wish to have a variable live longer than one scope or the scope it has been defined in, like that. Say you have some inner scope, and actually you wish to have that inner scope variable, which is called inner scope, live longer than the scope it has just been defined in, which would be that one. Just move it into the outer scope. Here we just move it to the outer scope variable. That is no problem, and then you can use it also outside, or its value at least. However, if the object is too large to be stored on the stack, I told you that the stack size is limited by the operating system for good reason. And if you have, like for instance, huge matrices, million and gazillion elements, so huge amount of data, then if the object is too large, store it using dynamic memory allocation on the heap. Okay, so if you need to allocate a fixed size array of object, just do so using stack memory. You can use the built-in array, but you shouldn't. You should instead use the std array wrapper type, which is in effect under the hood the same as this one, but it is a safe wrapper. It carries the size information. You can use it in range for loops, so that is the better C++ alternative, std array. If you need to dynamically allocate an array of objects, just use std vector, because std vector under the hood implements some dynamic array allocation. Now I got it. And it was created for this purpose. It's a safe wrapper for dynamically allocated arrays. I just mentioned that. And it also carries size information. You can use it in range for loops. So use std vector if you need some dynamically allocated array of objects. If you need raw, new, and delete nevertheless, try to use smart pointers rather than raw pointers. I will explain everything about smart pointers to you in, I believe, the next lecture even. So smart pointers take care of the deallocation, so they will automatically delete that stuff if it is no longer used. How come? How is that possible that smart pointers do the cleanup themselves, so you don't need to use delete? Smart pointers will do that for you, which is good, because then, first of all, you cannot leak anymore, but the question still is how can they do that? What they implement is something which is called reference counting. So smart pointers implement reference counting. So as long you have a reference to that heap memory, it stays there. And as soon as the reference goes down to zero and that piece of heap memory has no users anymore, it will be automatically deleted for you. So the technique is called reference counting that has been implemented. Python, I believe, also implements reference counting. And sometimes this is also called the poor man's garbage collector, because in Java you have a real garbage collector, which does some more clever stuff. But counting references is called sometimes the poor man's garbage collector. We will see them in one of the next lectures, exactly. All right, so recapping, what did we talk about today? Operator overloading. So you should now be able to overload your own operators. We discussed a program's memory layout, what those different segments are and what they're being used for. We talked about dynamic memory allocation, also for arrays, which is different than for objects, exactly. We discussed Dahlgren and Clang's address sanitizer and how those tools can be utilized to kind of check your program for memory errors. We discussed the copy constructor and the move constructor and their respective assignment version. And I gave you at the very end some notes on dynamic memory allocation. All right, that would be it. Have a nice day and see you in the exercise classes. Bye bye.